Okay, so hello guys, my name is Walter Sárác and my colleague is Tamás Horváth. We are electrical engineers from Hungary. We were part of the Hungarian Formula student team and we designed electrical race car. We will talk about accumulator design, but we will show you some interesting parts of the design phase, and we will not discuss the design procedure from start to beginning. We will give you guidelines. What is an accumulator and why do we need it? First of all, it stores energy, and but it has a disadvantage against petrol because it has it's less energy dense than petrol or diesel. But we cannot use petrol for an electric car, so that's why we need a high voltage battery. In Formula Student, we use high voltage, a couple of 100 volts DC, and it's a dangerous thing. So first we will talk about safety. How do you survive Formula Student? That's a good question. First of all, if you start to work on a high voltage system, especially on high voltage batteries, you have to be in good mental and physical condition. You have to focus on your work and don't be distracted by anything. Before you start your work, you have to clean up and tidy your mess in your workshop. That's the main thing. You cannot work alone on a high voltage system because if something happens, nobody can save your life if you are alone. You have to wear appropriate protective equipment like blast shields, high voltage gloves, and you have to be prepared with fire extinguishers. Before you start working on a high voltage accumulator, you have to plan your work, lay down the bullet points, what would you like to do on it, how would you do it, and design all the steps for it. Always have an emergency plan, because as you can see on the picture, we saw a high voltage Formula Student battery burn down, and it's not fun. And yeah, you have to be prepared for it because it can happen anytime. So more on the safety side, there's an important piece of a high voltage accumulator. It's called IMD, short for insulation monitoring device. It measures the resistance between the ground and the tractive system, positive and negative terminals. So if something goes wrong, it can shut down your system and you will be not shocked with high voltage DC. You have to check its functionality every time you use your high voltage accumulator or turn on your tractive system on the electrical car. So do you need a faster car or do you want fancy electronics? We have to talk about some vehicle dynamics before you start to design your high voltage accumulator. As you know, your battery is part of a huge system called a race car, and your main goal through the Formula Student competition is to have the most points, and you can achieve this by a good design and a fast car and a working car as well. So you have to have a reliable electronic system, and you can achieve this with good engineering practices. for a fast race car, you have to look at mass and the location of the mass. You have limited time and people to achieve this goal, and you have to follow your strict design parameters given by your main engineer. And so you will need inputs for the design from the main engineer. As I said, the main one is weight and the location of the weight, but you have to follow the competition rules for that. You will need the capacity, and you don't have to calculate it. You will get this as an input for your design. You will have to provide a sufficient output power for your tractive system, and you will have to put your battery into the smallest space possible to have space for other things in the car. As the project management side of the battery design, you will have to copy strict deadlines. You have to manage multiple designers, like mechanical engineers or electrical engineers as well. And you will have a finite amount of money, and it will drive the decision for cell selection and the case material as well. So I will hand you to Tamás Horváth, and he will talk about cell chemistries.
Yes, thank you, Walter. So first of all, for a battery, you need cells that stores the energy, and there are a lot of cell chemistry types, and these have different characteristics based on the chemistry. So our main types are lead acid. So this is a little bit heavy, but very reliable and do not need a lot of management circuits. Other nickel-based battery types, these have So nickel-based types are really good for can be really good for the design, but the best is lithium ion because of its energy density and the power that is stored in the cell, and we will discuss it in later. And you can see the cells have different shapes. For example, so this is the lead acid cells. These are really big and heavy. And this is a nickel-based battery type. And the lithium ion battery, this can be a punched cell or a cylindrical type. So it has a lot of shapes. And there are the characteristics of the cells based on the capacity discharge. So you can see it's a ash shape, and there is a plate in the middle. So most of the time, your cell will be in this region. And after it, we have to make our big choices. So for the cell chemistry, there are the main points of the voltage, the current, and there are two currents for us, the discharge current, which will drive the car, and the charge current, which we have during the braking, because it's really important for this former student to have regenerative braking, because in that case, we do not need so much accumulator. And based on the cell chemistry, we have different temperature ranges. And after it, we have the right cell chemistry, or we think we found the right cell chemistry. We should think about the configuration of the cells, how many cells in series, how many in parallel. This gives us the right capacity and the output power, which we need for our motors. And after it, we have to make a battery, which have stacks based on the rules, for example. And a really important question, how do we connect ourselves, the welding methods, for example, and how do we cool our battery? Do we need cooling as well? So about the cell chemistry, our focus points is the price. So everything costs money. And for example, the lead acid batteries are cheaper than the lithium polymer ones. So yeah, you can think about a really good battery, but if your team hasn't got enough money, it's a waste of time of thinking about lithium ion battery. And after it, there are the engineering side about the energy density and the power density. You can see in the picture the difference between the different cell chemistries. So in the top, there is the lithium ion chemistry. And because of that, we will talk about later. So we think this is the best option for a Formula student car, if you have enough money and enough knowledge for the best handling for the battery, maybe it's a good choice for a first year car to use lead acid battery because it doesn't need so much electronics and it's just easier to use. You can focus on your car structure, your team structure, and after it, you can develop your car, for example, with a better battery and chemistry. And after you choose the chemistry, in our case, the lithium ion, there are different shapes, as I said, punch cells, cylindrical cells, rectangular cells. You have to choose the right shape of your accumulator. The main input for that is the shape of your accumulator that is given by your main engineer. So maybe you have a L shape or anything like that in the car and not a easy rectangular form. In that case, designing the battery is a little bit more difficult. And within one chemistry type, there are different capacity for different batteries. And based on this capacity, we can calculate the possible charge and discharge current in the cells, which is measured in C. This means that capacity multiplied by this C value means that how much is the charge and discharge current for the cell. After that, you have to connect your cells. Why do you need it? Because you need capacity and output power. And as you can see the picture, you have to choose how many cells do you need in series and parallel. But a very important question for you is what will be your system voltage? So yeah, the rules said the maximum value, but you can choose below that anything you want. It's maybe your choice, but you know the Ohm's law. So if the voltage goes lower, the current goes higher for the same power. So it's a consideration that higher current needs a bigger cable. Bigger cable means bigger mass, bigger space in the car, bigger bending radius. For example, it could be difficult to bend a bigger cable at the outside of the car, for example, the wheel hub motors. So yeah, this is a little bit difficult design choice to have the right voltage level. because this isn't that simple to choose. For example, I want 500 volts, but you have cells with exact voltage level. So maybe there is no configuration for that voltage level. So there is always this or that questions during this process. And after you selected the configuration for you, there is another big topic, the connection method. So so soldering isn't the best option. This isn't allowed by a former student. You have to weld it some way. So there are different options for welding, or maybe you can use bolts or anything. And after that, you have to make stacks in the battery. So you have to have stacks in your battery because of the rules. And this is also a very big question. For example, in the cooling, if you want cooling, then you have to calculate the airflow. How can the air flow through the battery? So in the pictures, you can see different stack shapes and different configurations. For example, there are six shapes in that. And yeah, these are the modules in that shapes. And you can imagine if the air flows, for example, from the upper side, the air blocks in the cell, so the cooling isn't the best as for example, in the second one. So yes, if you choose your cell chemistry, your configuration, and your shape, you have to think about the required electronics, what you needed for it.
Yeah, so this picture, you can see the block design of a high voltage accumulator. You can see the cells itself here. And the main part of the battery is BMS. It's short for battery management system. It's a crucial part for lithium ion cell chemistry because you have to monitor the cell voltages and temperatures every time, because if they go over a threshold, your battery or even your workshop can burn down. So you cannot overcharge and cannot discharge for under voltage those cells. So the positive and the negative side of the battery goes directly into the airs, which are accumulator isolation relays. This will isolate your high voltage battery from the rest of the car if something goes wrong. On the right side of the airs, you will have the motor controller and inverter, which has huge DC capacitors on the DC bus. And before you turn on the airs, you have to precharge those capacitors. So you will need a precharge circuit for that. When you are finished with your racing or runs, after you turn off your airs, you will need to discharge those capacitors, as I talked about, and you will need a robust discharge system for that. Before the high voltage connector, you will have a main fuse in the accumulator enclosure. That's a requirement by the rules. Okay,
so first of all, let's talk about the discharge circuit, because we said safety first. So this is the unit that take away the electrons in the outside of the accumulator, and you will be not shocked. So this is not for the rules, it's for your safety. For example, first of all, you have to make appropriate ratings based about the energy that have to be discharged. It's about your intermediate capacitors and the discharge time and the temperature. So you have to be a backup or measurement circuit if your discharge circuit temperature goes high, and you need to handle it. You need to cool your discharge circuit. You need to switch off for your discharge circuit for a different amount of time to save the circuit. And after it is cooled down, you can switch it on. And there are different solutions in electronics for everything, but for discharge, there is two common solutions. First of all, what you can see in the picture is the resistor-based discharge circuit. So in the middle, there is the intermediate capacitor, and there are the discharge resistor in the right side. So in the state of the switch, the resistor connected to the capacitor and discharge it. Of course, you have to make calculations for the time of the discharge, as the rule said as well. And you have to make proper power ratings for your discharge circuit, proper cooling if it needed. And there is an advanced method for discharge circuit, which is a constant current discharge. It's made by transistors. So in that case, the dissipating the dissipating element isn't a resistor. It's a transistor. It could be a MOSFET or anything like that. And in that case, your discharge time could be faster and more linear. It can give you some design points as well, because yeah, this is a more advanced solution for that. But as I said, safety is the first. So you have to have a reliable discharge circuit. And after it, you can make fancy electronics. And the battery management system. So I think this is the most difficult part of the electrical side of the accumulator in the electrical design. So it can have a lot of functions, but the main functions are the voltage measurement and the temperature measurement of the cells. So for the lithium ion cells, as you can see in the picture, there are a really small operating window based on the temperature and the cell voltage. And out of these windows, there can be not so good time. So for example, a burning accumulator or anything like that. And your main goal is to hold your battery and your cells between in this window. So you have circuits that helps you in that. For example, in the main switch, so the accumulator isn't in the right window, you can switch off your airs, and yeah, you don't discharge your cells too much. And your BMS circuit controls as well the discharge and the precharge circuit, as you can see in earlier. And there can be other important functions for your battery management system, as balancing your cells. So you would like to store as much energy as possible in your accumulator, but the cells isn't the same, even if the chemistry is the same. So there are different internal resistance for the cells. And because of that, there is a different discharge for the cells. And if you run a lot of your accumulator, the cells can be different voltage levels. So your balanced circuit is for that, to equalize the voltage level of your cells. And in that case, you can store the most possible energy in the battery. And of course, in a formal student car, you have to communicate between your units. So the battery management system will send messages for the other electronics of the car. And based on that, you can make other controlling decisions. Yes, so the next one is the pre-charge circuit. So why we need it? Yes, because of the rules. And the most and the important thing is that your accumulator stores DC energy, but when you turn on your battery, it's like more the alternating current. So it goes through the intermediate capacitors, and this act like a short circuit. And this can damage your accumulator, your high voltage cables, your main fuse can blow up, and all of your connected system can be damaged because there is a possibility that they are isn't for the short circuit current. So the pre-charge circuit act like a resistor, which blocks the short circuit, and you can set the discharge current, sorry, the charge current that you use to charge your intermediate capacitors. And after the intermediate capacitors are charged for the levels that is defined by the rules or defined by you, you can switch on the RS. And in that case, you are happy you saved your systems and the accumulators and the cables as well.
So we will talk about the ARs. As I said, it's accumulator isolation relays. You have to choose an appropriate one for your system. The inputs for these decisions are voltage and current ratings. So you will need two ARs in the accumulator container, one for the positive and one for the negative terminal as well. So main things when you choose this component are the weight of this, the price, the different relay structures, and you can find some relays with a secondary connector. And with those secondary connectors, you can monitor your ARs, whether they are contact welded or stuck in a closed position or not. I think that's all about ARs.
Yes, and the main fuse. So this is also for your safety. You have to choose it based on the voltage and current rating. And of course, there is a maximum temperature limit for the fuse as well. It's a really easy choose for that part of the voltage and current, but the different, so the difficult task for that is to calculate the interrupt time, which is really important because in that case that your fuse blow up, but if it's too slow, it can damage your accumulator. So the reason for our accumulator fire was that our fuse wasn't the right. So we made mistakes in the calculations. So the fuse blow up too slow. And because of that, the cells are damaged. And this caused later the fire. So yeah, that's a really difficult question to make a good interrupt time, because you have different parts of the event. For example, in the acceleration, there is a high current, but in the endurance, you have a steady and less current than the acceleration, and you have one fuse for both event, and this have to have a good acting fuse for the failure as well. And yeah, you have to think about a lot of things when you choose your fuse. And it's a funny picture in the ride, so there is a possibility to replace your fuse, but it's not recommended.
And the last part of your accumulator container is the high voltage connectors. You have to look for your system voltage and current as well. As we said before, if you choose a higher system voltage, you will need to carry lower currents, and your connector can be smaller and lighter. Other important things when you choose your connector is to select one with automotive certifications, because you will use these connectors in an automotive environment. You will need to connect these connectors easily with a high voltage gloves on. We have seen this on competitions when the team could only connect their high voltage connectors with calipers, and that was a really bad design, as you can imagine. And you have to assemble your connector easily, because sometimes you have to repair those connections during an event, and it's way more effective if you find a proper connector that you can reassemble quickly. And we are finished with our presentation, and I hope you know everything designing a battery, high voltage battery, and we are ready for your questions. So let's start with the Q&A part of it.
My first question is about battery integrator. Is it a voltmeter or simple like lamp or something?
Sorry, can you repeat your questions, because we couldn't hear the first part of it?
The battery indicator, where to place it, and what kind of to use, the voltmeter or the simple lamp?
So, as we mentioned earlier, the first task is to build a working car. So I think in the first years, simple LED is a very good solution with some resistors. And yeah, in that case, you discharge your accumulator a lot or more than a more advanced solution. But I think in the beginning, you need to use a simpler design, which is functional every time. And after it, you can go to the more advanced line.
Thanks. And we have another question. Our team find quite difficult to find isolating blanket, because all the biggest we can find is 36 inches. It's less than 1 square meter. Do you have any suggestions or specific manufacturer who we can buy the blanket from?
I think we had a beta high voltage blanket, but the team purchased it a lot of years ago, so we cannot give you an exact location where you can find one, but yeah, there are existing large high voltage blankets.
But yeah, so we can look after for our friends that are now informal student. I think there is a way that you can, you send us emails, for example, through Andre, and we can make these questions and we can look after it. So right now we can't set the exact part number, but we can look after it if you need it.
Yep, it will be quite nice. Thanks.
You're welcome.
Hello, my name is Pavel. First of all, thank you for your presentation. It was very interesting. My question is about thermal management simulation. What you can advise to start from this temperature management model, or so how you do it in your way?
So the temperature management for your battery. Not yeah. not for the cells, for the whole battery, yeah?
Yeah, for whole battery, yeah.
Yeah, so the first one is the output power that you need in the accumulator for the motors and for the inverters. And after it, you have to measure, or you need to find the internal resistance of the cells, because yeah, you in that way, you know the output current, you know the resistance of the cell, you know the cell configuration, and because of that, you can calculate the dissipated energy, the yeah, the this
so, we have a language problem, but yeah,
so yeah, this is the this is the dissipated energy that is by the calculations, and in the real world it can be a little bit smaller or higher, but this is the starting point that you calculate that energy, and after that you have to think about the heat capacitance of the cells, so how much energy needed for one temperature warmer, and after that you can make the calculations for the cooling, for example. We saw different kind of coolings, for example air-based coolings or oil-based coolings or Sárazég.
You can use dry ice as well.
Yeah, so
but yeah, there are a lot of things use air cooling for the batteries. A couple of teams, I don't know, use oil based. So yeah, the air cooling is the simplest and you can start with that.
But I can say that the best teams isn't use cooling. So the heat capacitance of the cells are enough for the endurance event. If your system is really really at the high standard, so your inverters and yeah, the whole system doesn't need so much power, in that case maybe you didn't need cooling.
Yeah, you calculate cooling for endurance event. Yeah. And the amount of thermal energy must be in the level of
And of course there is a rule for the maximum temperature, but the maximum temperature that is allowed by the cell manufacturer, this can be other one, so you have to make the right consideration for that for what is the maximum cell temperature that is allowed for your accumulator.
Mm-hmm. And one more. Do you have some energy profile maybe for discharge and recuperation? How recuperation is affect to thermal increasing of temperature?
Sorry, we didn't get it. Can you repeat it?
Question about recuperation.
We got it.
So recuperation for thermal part is the same as discharging, because that's only current. For the thermal parts, it doesn't act anything that goes that way or that way. So that isn't the part of the calculation, I think. So you need the current rating for the wall endurance event. So that is an average current rating that you can measure or calculate anyway. And for that average current rating, which is a part of the discharge current and the charge current. So you have to calculate both of them, but these are the same current as for the thermal part.
Mm-hmm. Okay. One more question. Okay. As I can see in your presentation, you're using cylindrical lithium ion cells, yeah?
No, for our battery, we use punch type cells because this is just a better shape for places next to each other. So in the cylindrical parts, there is a lot of place for the air, so there is a lot of space that isn't used. And in the former sedan car, there aren't a lot of space, I think. Mm-hmm. So yeah, because of that, we use punch type cells from Malasta, like I said.
Okay. And how you connect their connectors together? With welding or?
Yeah, these were laser welded to a copper bus. So there is a PCB. So this is the cell. There is the PCB on that, and the cells are bonded to the copper bus.
The cell stubs.
Sorry. And this is laser bonded to the copper, and the copper connects each other and the PCB.
Yeah. And for the battery management system, you can take the voltage measurement and the temperature measurements as well from the copper bus bars, because they are directly and metallic connected to the cells.
Yeah, so there was a hole in the copper tab below the laser welding, and there is a temperature monitoring IC, TMP-100 from Texas Instrument. And this is responsible for the temperature measurement.
Okay. And you use a laser welding, and it isn't yours, it's made on site, yeah, something.
So we had a partner with that machine, and we goes to that, and we make the weldings, but not in our equipment.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. And maybe the last question about your team. I don't know, sorry, but how your team starts from internal combustion engine formula, or your team starts first in electric?
Yeah, so we were part of BME Formula Racing team. The team started with internal combustion engine, I think 2008. Yeah. So it was a long time ago. And a couple years later, they started to develop their first electric car next to the internal combustion as well.
In 2012, I think.
Yeah, so they had experience already with designing for a student car. And I think the first electric car was really heavy, like 300 or I don't know, maybe 400 kilograms.
Yeah.
So they went for reliability, not for a fast race car. And a couple of years later, when they had internal combustion and electric as well, they went to electric only. And I think 2 years ago, we started to build driverless as well. And now we have a driverless and electric vehicle as well. So I can tell you that the internal combustion race car is the first starting point for the former student competitions.
Mm-hmm. And yeah, I asked it in terms of the second question. Is there now we are a combustion team, yeah, and we try to make an electric car. And is there any communication problems between mechanical guys and electrical guys, maybe? How you solve it, and is there any, you know?
The most difficult part of that for the mechanical guys, the electronic side is magic, and this causes a lot of frustration because they just see the car that didn't work and they can't do anything because electronic is magic. And yeah, this is a real difficult question and task to solve that the mechanical guys understand a little bit the electrical side. But for the project management side, for the first 1 or 2 years, the electrical part will be the most challenging. So maybe for project management, you have to make mechanical guys to the electrical, for example, the cable harness. This is a very, very mechanical part, and this can give us a lot of help for the electrical team, that a mechanical guy comes and make the cable harness, for example. But I think the most important things that the mechanical guys have to have the basic electrical knowledge, for example, Ohm's law and this type of knowledge, because it's not so good that the half of your team doesn't know anything about the working of your car, because they see just the outside of it, yeah. And the inside is magic.
Yeah, it's a good thing to educate your team members from the electric race car and the electrical system of it, so they can better understand it and maybe understand the problems or design decisions behind those things. I think that's an important thing.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
You're welcome.
Hello.
Hello.
My name is Yuri. I'm from Staletti Racing Team. I'm not electrical, my question is the current EV 5.4.8 formal student rules talk about red indicator on the battery box, which should light up when the battery. Sorry. Red indicator on the battery box, which should light up when the battery voltage is more than 60 volts. This indicator should simply report the battery charge level, or say that something is wrong with it.
So you have questions about the T-cell circuit, as I think, yeah?
No, he said the battery indicator light, yeah?
Yeah.
Can you repeat the number of the rule that you said at the beginning? Because we are looking for the competition rule, so we can answer your question clearly.
EV 5.4.8.
Yeah, okay, we got this.
So you have to have a voltage measurement in your accumulator, but you don't have to think about digital measurement, for example, analog bands are perfect. And there is just a LED that have to eliminate when the voltage is bigger than 60 volts.
You said that your question was whether it should indicate your battery charge status. And for that, the answer is no. It only has to show you whether the high voltage is outside of your battery box. So it's a safety thing. If the voltage of the battery is over 60 watts or over the half of the maximum tractive system voltage, the LED must illuminate, and this will show you that there's a dangerous voltage on the accumulator connector. I hope I answered your question, but
now just feel free to ask.
Yeah.
So thank you.
You're welcome.
Hello.
Hello.
My name is Alexander. First of all, thank you for your great presentation. I have two questions for you. First question, we have two types of lithium battery cells, lithium polymer and lithium ion. Which better to use?
Lithium polymer is lithium ion just in polymer housing. So the chemistry is the same. Polymer means that the housing of the cells is polymer based.
Ah, okay, thank you. Second question. If we want to create own battery management system, which problem come to this way, on this way?
There is a lot of problem possibilities. So
yeah, when we designed our own battery management system, we had a lot of problems, like problems with the voltage measurements, problems with the voltage measurement IC as well. My main advice would be that keep it as simple as possible for your circuit and use available parts and mass produced one, because you will go through them during testing like never before and they will die easily. That's all I think from my side.
Yeah, and the other difficult part that your BMS is working in the table, that doesn't mean that this will work in your car because of the electromagnetic in your car, which is caused by your motors and your inverters. So we have serious problems with that. You have to have reliable communication between your units in the battery packs, because in our car the motor controller and the battery are really close to each other, and there is a very high interference in the beginning when we haven't had the right voltage levels. So we use ISO SPI communication, but we have to find the right level of the communication, because we have problems when during the acceleration, when the most current is it, and in that case there is the highest the AMC, and is interfered with the communication.
Yeah, for that you can use shielded cables for the communication between the stacks.
Twisted cables, yeah. Really important.
Yeah.
I understand it so far.
Okay, you're welcome.
Okay, Walter Tamas, a big thank you to you, and it seems like no more question. So thank you again for your presentation. It definitely will help to the team. And yeah, hope to see you in Hungary.
Yeah. And as I said earlier, when there is another question, you can send us an email and we try to answer it.
Yeah.
Okay.
And thank you for the opportunity.
Okay, so bye.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Goodbye.